to doubt God. The devil desires to divide the body so that he can ultimately destroy you. That's what John 10 and 10 tells us. The devil comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He don't mind you shouting as long as you're not getting truth. He doesn't mind you high-fiving your neighbor as long as you're not being taught and being fed the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And what the enemy's trying to do, he's trying to control your mind in order to cause you to live a life that's substandard and subpar to what God created you for. He created us to be the head and not the tail. He created us to be the lender and not the borrower. He created us to be more than a conqueror and victorious and not defeated. He created us to be an heir and joint heir. He created us to be a part of the royal priesthood. Anything else the devil tells you, it's a lie. That's a lie. And so he wants your mind. Tell your neighbor, he wants your mind. And that was the trick of the enemy in Mark 5. He wanted this young black man's mind. He wanted his brother's mind. Because if he can control his mentality, he can control his reality. How do I know his mentality had been captured by the enemy? Because I took a look at his reality. Look at where this brother was living. Look at how this brother was carrying himself. The word says that Jesus and his disciples had touched down from the country of the Gadarenes. Getting off the ship, and immediately they run unto him, a man with an unclean spirit. Jesus looks at him and knows something's wrong with this man's mind. He knows that this man is not thinking logically. He's not thinking rationally. Matter of fact, Jesus already concludes that this man is being controlled demonically. I'll deal with that in a second. And the Bible says that when this man runs up to Jesus, he begins to call a creative conversation with Jesus. And what I realize about this brother's life that confirmed to me that this brother's mentality was controlled by the demonic hand of the enemy, because first of all, this brother's life indicated that he thought his life was over. But I need you to preach to somebody and tell them it ain't over for you. It's not over for you. How do I know this brother thought his life was over? Because the Bible says that he had his dwellings, he resided, he lived in the tombs. He had his dwelling amongst the tombs. He lived in a graveyard. A graveyard denotes a dead environment. And so he was a living being living in a dead environment. Rationally and logically, nobody that's alive would set up shop in a dead environment unless your mind had been demonically manipulated into believing that you were already dead. And I'm here to speak life into every pastor, speak life into every ministry leader. Don't you dare let the devil trick you into thinking that your ministry is dead. I don't care if nobody joined the church this year. I don't care if nobody came to get involved this year. God is still breathing life into your ministry, into your family, into your finances. Don't you allow the enemy to manipulate your reality, because you got to see beyond what you see. He starts setting up shop in a graveyard. He's living amongst dead people. The enemy had manipulated his mind into thinking that this was the best environment for him to dwell in. And some of you don't want to admit it on this official night, but you have become connected to some dead folk. How do I know you're connected with dead folk, and how can you tell who's dead? Well, all you gotta do is look at the lack of productivity in their life. You've got folk connected to you that ain't doing nothing, ain't going nowhere, and don't want nothing. Just dead vision. You hooked up with some dead folk. Oh, but the biggest mistake the devil ever made, oh, was to allow you to become and to cross the path with life. That's why Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And what the Lord wants you to know tonight, that there's still some life for you. Oh, glory be to God. And so this brother's mind was so manipulated that he thought his life was over. That's why he's dwelling amongst the tombs. But secondarily, I know that this brother's mind was manipulated not only because he thought his life was over, but secondarily, he thought everybody was against him. Oh, glory be to God. Because every time he turned around, the Bible says that they were tying him up and binding him up with chains and fetters. And I'm sure the devil talked him into the fact that, man, they just hating on you. Man, they jealous of you. Man, they trying to keep you down. But the reality was that they were in fact trying to help him and not hurt him. But when your sense of reality has been skewed by sin and the devil, when folk tell you the truth, you get in your feelings as if they're trying to hurt you. When the preacher tells you, girl, the wages of sin is death, you get mad at the preacher. When the preacher tells you, my brother, that instead of you shacking up with her, you ought to have enough respect to give her no last name and live under the roof in the order of God's ordained marriage, you get mad at the gospel. But as long as we're telling you, just turn around three times and everything's going to be all right, just high-five your neighbor and God's going to open up a window of heaven, you'll shout the walls down. But you preachers got to stand on the truth.